a lot that you don't interact with, to be connected to the internet. So mbed is about making these billions of devices, or how you actually develop them. So it's making the creation of these devices possible. And there's a lot that's been changing in the world of microcontrollers over the last decade. For starters, microcontrollers are getting extremely cheap. You can get a pretty high performance microcontroller in a 5x5 millimeter package for less than a dollar. And they're also becoming very powerful. So lots of processing, tons of memory, and I/O all in a single package. And beyond all that, connectivity is starting to become included. So these system on a chips are now coming with a way to wire or wirelessly connect them to the internet over lots of great technologies that are being provided by partners. So all of these things put together creates new opportunities for microcontrollers to connect to the internet. And also there's been a big change in the way people develop software, particularly for computers moving on to microcontrollers. So back in the 90s, we were sitting at our terminals punching in assembler commands to get a program to run. And in the early 2000s, the C programming language really took off. You know, students and younger people were starting to get enthusiastic about the portability of the code and the verbosity of it. And you look at 2010 and until now, examples like iOS and Android, the platform approach where there's a common SDK that you can write lots of things against, which as a developer makes you extremely productive with very little knowledge of the hardware that's underneath it. And so you look at how all these things fit together and where mbed is focusing, and it's the things. It's the things on the left-hand side. It's embedding the connectivity and the tiny bit of intelligence to get the information that these devices are producing onto the internet so we can make smart decisions about the way things happen and interact with them as well. So the ARM mbed platform for Cortex-M is open source, Apache license for the code base. There's a online IDE and developer ecosystem, and again, this is targeting developing embedded products, so things with microcontrollers inside. It's designed to enable the IoT device creation market on a massive scale. So if we're going to see these tens, 20s, 50s, and hundreds of billions of devices, that's a lot of development man hours that are needed. And the tools that are needed to do that may have a little different look and feel. And it also opens up the IoT marketplace to a whole new set of professional developers. It may not just be people who have a background in embedded systems or in low-level programming languages. People who are just more familiar with getting a code base and writing applications against it are now going to be comfortable in this space as well. So mbed provides access to the fundamental building blocks to make all this possible. So we bring together partners with microcontrollers and different radio technologies and sensors and software stacks, pull all the glue into one place so that developers have the resources they need to build these internet-connected devices. And all the hardware comes with there's reference design. So once you do prototype an idea, it's not that difficult to take it to a custom form factor or custom product. All the information you need is at your fingertips. And we have a fairly vibrant developer community. We have over 95,000 users at this point, and that number continues to keep growing. Almost 10,000 public code repositories. This is where people are contributing examples and libraries back so other people can build off of what they've done. And there's over 300 component entries, and a component's a key building block as well to building internet-connected things. So if you have a microcontroller and if you have some sort of connectivity, now you need to start sensing the world around you to make decisions and to move that data somewhere else where it's meaningful. That's where the components come in. So mbed is a technical collaboration. It's managed by ARM, and it's focused on enabling rapid development for developers. We enable and foster a collaborative ecosystem to where all the pieces you would need to build a successful IoT product are brought together in one place. And it provides wide technical accessibility to the developers who need this technology in a digestible way. So I'd like to switch gears for a minute and talk with you all about getting started. So when you do get a piece of mbed hardware and mbed platform, what it's like getting out of the box and how you would actually create your first program and execute it. So step number one would be to get a piece of mbed hardware and connect it to your computer, Windows, Mac, or Linux. When you connect that piece of hardware to your computer across the USB cable, it'll present itself as a USB storage device or like a USB thumb drive. And there'll be a redirect or a shortcut file that'll drive you to mbed. That's called mbed.htm. So if you double click that file, it's going to drive you to either a login or a sign up page. If you've created an account before, you can just log in. And if it's your first time, welcome. Go ahead and sign up. It'll ask you for a few questions, namely an email address and a username, and you'll be ready to go. So at any point in the future, that mbed HTM file, once you're logged into mbed.org, will take you to your platform page. So the platform page is where the resources are for your hardware. You'll find some connection diagrams with friendly pin names that can be used in your code. That way, you can look at a quick image picture and write your code, be very productive that way. And you'll also find links to example programs, something that you can import and compile just to verify your hardware's up and running. It may be a good start for your application as well. So if we take another look at programs or a closer look, this is how a program is presented. There's a lot of tabs across the top. You can see the revision history of a program, some API documentation. There may be a wiki page that goes over the details of how to use it or how to get up and running very quickly. And if you're the owner, you'll see some administration settings. And on the right-hand side a little bit further, there's a repository toolbox. So from this toolbox, you can import the program to your personal workspace, the mbed IDE. You could export it to a desktop IDE. You could build the repository as it is and just get the binary artifact to put on your device and make it functional. A few other things as well. And then you'll also see some repository details. So you can find out how many times it's been imported, how popular it is, are people forking it and creating other programs like it, are there dependencies, and are there people following it. So at this point, we would import this program, and that'll open up the mbed IDE. So the mbed IDE is a web-hosted code editor with a compiler on the back end. So you can actually edit your code in the browser. When you hit the compile button, it'll submit a build job on the servers and kick you back a binary file. So that binary file now needs to be saved onto the mbed disk drive that was present on the computer, hitting just the reset button, and then it would be executing and running your new program. A couple things to note here. All browsers behave differently, usually based on the user settings. So sometimes it'll prompt you with a dialog like this, where to save your files. Sometimes it's just gonna automatically download into your downloads directory. So your interface here may vary a little bit. And then there's also some build details. So say you wanted to know a little bit more about how much memory was being used to run that program, so you could determine what type of the resources you have left. That'll pop up on the right-hand side. And for just a sec, I'd like to go over a few more features of the online IDE. So this is your portal. This is where you're doing your development work. This is where you're editing code and compiling. This is all C and C++. So on the left-hand side, you'll see a fairly typical program workspace where you can have your main files, your libraries and dependencies, lots of documentation. And you'll notice the little green circle on the mbed library. That's indicating to us that there's an update available, that there's been changes that are not part of our product, or part of our project. And so the website and the IDE support integrated version control. So you can at any point switch back to a point in history, update, merge, the typical development workflows for sharing and collaborating. On the right-hand side, you'll see the platform selection. So that's where you can choose the piece of hardware that you're developing for and switch between them. And then you can also see program and library details on the right-hand side. And that's going to take you back to that URL, to that program homepage, where the documentation and other information is. And it'll also tell you if there's a newer version available and a bit of a description about it. So if we have a program in our workspace, we probably want to extend it and add some components, because the components and the sensors are what make this all very interesting. So there's a component database on mbed. The component database is going to give you a few ways to find things you need to hook up to your platform and make it do things. So you can search it just across the top, or you can see a list on the left-hand side of categories. And if you drill through the categories, you can then find a particular sensor or actuator that you'll need to enhance your design. So here we have an example component entry. There's a Hello World program, so it's very easy to get a piece of hardware, hook it up to a platform, and just import that program. And what that program will allow you to do is evaluate the component. Does it behave how it should? Does it pass the testing, or is it the right one? Does it have the proper resolution or sensitivity that you need? And if you're already well aware of that and you know it is what you want, then you can just import the library. In the library, if that goes directly into your program, now you can just make API calls directly against that piece of hardware, which will then give more personality, if you will, to your program. So when we're at this event, we'll be wandering around helping people out. If you do have questions, take a note of this, http://bit.ly/teammbed. So here you're going to find kind of a landing page where all of Team Embed's partners are going to come together, put some Hello World examples, maybe some wiki documentation on how to use the particular technology. And then we also have this community tab. And the nice thing about the community tab is you can ask questions or start discussions. So there'll be a lot of people using this platform and these tools at the event. So that's a great way to get help as well without actually having to flag down somebody from Team Embed. The community does moderate and help itself out very well. So in summary, we talked a bit about the Embed IDE, that's a C++ and C code editing system with a back-end compiler. There's lots of documentation and integrated viewing, distributed version control, dependency tracking, wiki bug tracking, components, and there's a massive community. So I think at this point you have enough knowledge to be powerful and productive using the Embed development platform to build your next device. So thank you all for your attention, and at this point I'd like to pass it to Ian Galloway of Freescale.
Hello?
Hi, Ian. Trying to get you control, so just one second.
All right, yeah. There we go. Hang on. Okay, are people seeing my PowerPoint? Yeah, okay, so my name's Ian Galloway. I'm with Freescale Semiconductor. Here to present some of the Freescale technology we're showing. Freescale's brand of ARM Cortex-M is called Kinetis. So Kinetis microcontrollers represent a wide variety of different parts. We've got a very wide portfolio. Different letters represent different specialized features of the part. So there's Kinetis K, which is our sort of mainline products. Kinetis V is specifically for motor control. M is for metering or metrology, making power meters, for example. W has various wireless connectivity options, sub gigahertz, 2.4 gigahertz, Bluetooth. L is a Cortex-M0 Plus based one, so it's the lowest power version of Kinetis. E is the 5-volt ruggedized versions, and EA is for automotive. And then there's a subgroup called Kinetis Mini, which are in tiny, tiny chip scale packages. So we're going to be using Kinetis K at the hackathon on our Freedom boards, they're called. Again, within the Kinetis K family, there's a bunch of subgroupings, product lines. I won't go through all the details, but you can see on the slide each one has a set of different features. They kind of build upon each other until you get to Kinetis K6 family. And we'll be using K64, which is one of the newest iterations of the Kinetis K60 family. So it's 120, up to 120 megahertz processor, a megabyte of flash, lots of features like USB, et cetera. I'll go over that. So on the Freedom Development Board for this Kinetis K64, the processor has lots of flash, a mega flash, 256K of SRAM, runs USB without needing a crystal. On the board itself, there's also an accelerometer and a magnetometer, so you can use that to point north and then use the tilting of the board in three axis to as part of an input to a system. There's an LED, a red, green, blue LED. It can be powered in a variety of ways from either of the USB ports or through the headers, and it follows the Arduino R3 pin layout. It's compatible with the R3 pin layout. It has, as you might notice, an extra row of pins on the inside, so there's a lot of additional functionality that's brought out there. At the back corner here, you can see there's a spot for an SD card. We have USB that belongs to the processor itself, so that goes directly to the processor, and particularly useful in Internet of Things devices is the fact that it has Ethernet built onto the chip, and the PHY is right here. There are a couple of additional headers. We probably won't be using them at the hackathon, but I'll just bring it to your attention. One's for a Bluetooth radio that can plug in, and also a 2.4 gigahertz radio. But there's lots of interesting products from, you know, u-blox and Nordic that would plug into these headers. And Multitech also has a radio. So we'll be using that type of thing in the hackathon. On the board, a little bit more of an overview. This, in the top right-hand corner, the yellow dotted line section is the debugger. So that's the mbed debugger that's built onto the board. And the important point to highlight is there is a reset button up here in the corner, and that's the button that you may need to restart a program or kick off a program. The USB on the top left is part of the processor's direct USB, and you can see the rest of the components. If you were to do a more offline debugging session, you would use this particular JTAG header. But again, we won't be doing that during the hackathon. And you can see there's a lot of extra pins available compared to the Arduino R3 format. This is technically the Freedom, the Kinetis pinout names, and how they relate to the Arduino R3 signal. But if you look on the components page of mbed, it would be best to use the mbed names. So, you know, instead of PTC, in the bottom right-hand corner, instead of using PTC16, you should use D0, and then it'll be most compatible across different mbed boards. But you can also see that many pins have multiple functions. So up here, the green is the STI port. It also doubles up if you need to use those pins for pulse width modulation or just general purpose IOs. The bootloader, I highlighted earlier, it's kind of interesting. Basically, there is a second processor on here that's running as the bootloader and, it's actually OpenSDA, which is a program that includes a bootloader but also includes an application. So what it lets you do is put different applications in here. So you can see that you could be a mass storage target programmer or a P&E debugger or a SimSys DAP debugger or other programs can fit into there. But the bootloader is always in place that lets you swap out these different programs. So we will be using the mbed mass storage programmer, the mass storage application. And what that does is a couple of things. Mostly it programs the target processor, the K64 in this case. You compile your mbed code, as Sam said, and then you just drag and drop it over to the board, and it will program the processor. It also does provide a serial port connection through the USB of the open SDA microcontroller. So then you have a way of debugging and reading, you know, printing things back to the screen. And so this is really provide the easy to use drag and drop interface. But I would like to highlight that, you know, you can swap this out at as you get do more advanced programming with a full featured debugger and you know, do offline compiling and things like that to really get to a commercial type application. On our webpage, we have a lot of technical details about the board and the documentation behind the chip in case you may need that. Of course, we're going to be handy as well at the hackathon, and we're happy to help out as much as possible. But I would like to highlight that there's a tab here, documentation tab, that includes all the technical user manuals and user guides that go along with this processor. We're also going to be showing for the first time a brushed DC motor shield that plugs on, and these will be available, and we'll get some we'll have some motors there available as well. So this is a an H-bridge driver, and there's some examples already on mbed to use this. So I know in the past at different hackathons there's been people that have opened little garage doors or fired a ping pong ball across the room or whatnot. So this could easily be the kind of shield that you would add on that plugs on top of the K64 and lets you control a motor with an a Freescale H-bridge, the MPC17510, which is a low voltage, I think it goes up to 6 volts H-bridge. We do have some HL511, which is up to 16 volt driver as well, that will bring some of those with us as well. So we're happy, we're excited if people want to use this board. And the only thing to point out, it's pretty easy to use. You put the motor across the out one and out two terminals and your power supply as the power supply input. So if you were using 12 volts, that would go there. These boards are up to 6 volts. So I actually in past have soldered a little wire from this pin, it's highlighted with an orange circle, and jumpered it into there, and that lets you just run everything off of the single USB power supply. You have to be careful that you don't overload it, but overload the power supply, but in many cases that's perfectly fine. So if you use a PWM to feed the H-bridge, then you can get very precise motor control out of it. And finally, there's some links here. I'm not sure where to, if you'll have the presentation available, but please email me if you take note of my email address. If you email me, I'll send you this email, this presentation, or answer any questions you might have. And these are links to the various components and documentation you may need to be successful in the hackathon. We're going to have a good team of people there to help out with things. And please come and see us and get your Freescale boards. And now I'll pass it on. Let's see. There we go. Assign to Sean Newton. There we go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sean Newton from STMicroelectronics. Wait. Okay. Can everybody see the presentation? Okay, welcome to this Team Embed Bootstrap tutorial about ST's STM32F411 Nucleo board. The STM32 Nucleo board is the hardware starting point for implementing your next connected device at AT&T, at the AT&T Hackathon. ST has partnered with Team Embed to bring a hardware development platform that will make the realization of your embedded device for the connected car, connected home, or wearable easy to create. With a plethora of sensors to choose from, plus the ability to use various connectivity modules, you will have at your disposal the raw materials to build the connected embedded device of your dreams. So for this hackathon, ST is supplying 100 STM32 Nucleo boards for all the participants. You can think of the Nucleo board as an independent computer or the brains for your connected device. At the heart of the Nucleo board is an STM32 32-bit ARM Cortex-M4 microcontroller, which is easily programmed with mbed. On the top side of the board is a mini USB connector. This USB interface supplies power to your device and contains a programming and debugging interface used to load your mbed code. Finally, this board has an Arduino connector that allows you to stack Arduino shield boards together, giving you the ability to add wireless connectivity, sensors, and additional user input/output to your device. All the GPIO pins of the microcontroller are fully exposed through an additional header, giving maximum flexibility to connect other electronic components. And detailed information of this board can be found at st.com/STM32Nucleo. Let's look at the basics of the development environment. With your Nucleo board, you will receive a USB cable. And you'll take that cable, connect your Nucleo board to your PC. As explained earlier, the mbed development environment gives you all the tools needed to develop and program the STM32 by providing a hardware abstraction layer with easy-to-use APIs. You'll write and compile your C or C++ code through your web browser using mbed's online code editor and compiler. Now, here's a hacker tip to get ready for the show. Go visit mbed.org and start browsing through the many component libraries and examples available. This will give you ideas on what is possible for your connected device. Now I will show you how easy it is to develop your next connected device. Step number one, when you arrive at the hackathon, come to the ST table and grab an STM32 Nucleo board and a USB cable. This is the foundation of the development platform. Step number two, go to mbed.org and log in. Connect your Nucleo board to your PC. Under Platforms, select the ST Nucleo F411RE. Then choose a simple example program and compile and download it to the Nucleo board. At this point, your development environment is fully functional. Step number three, find connectivity. Grab one of many mbed-ready connectivity modules at the hackathon. Plug the module into the Nucleo's Arduino connector. Then within the mbed development environment, find the module's pre-built communication library and the example project code. Compile, download, and test, and your wireless communication should be up and running. Number four, find sensors and I/O. Team mbed has also brought a multitude of sensor kits with many options to choose. Select the sensors and other I/O devices needed for your application and connect them to the Nucleo board. Several of the sensors have pre-built mbed libraries and examples available. Just code and play. With the sensors and additional user input outputs, your device now has the ability to measure or control things in the real world. And finally, complete your device by writing the application code needed to connect to cloud services such as AT&T's M2X, a smartphone, a car, or another device. With a little bit of blood, sweat, and tears, you have the creature. Although it may not look elegant, your creature now has the ability to show your complete end-to-end proof of concept, ready to wow the judges and move from hack to product. Let's review connectivity and sensor options. At this hackathon, many connectivity options are available, such as Bluetooth low energy, cellular modem, NFC smart tag radio, LoRa radio, and Wi-Fi. All modules plug into the STM32 Nucleo board and have mbed-ready libraries. Also available through mbed is the AT&T M2X socket library that will connect your device to AT&T's M2X cloud services. As previously mentioned, ARM is bringing many sensor and I/O options that you can choose from and build your connected device. Starting with the Arduino sensor shield, you can connect many sensors like temperature, humidity, pressure, accelerometer, gyroscope, and many, many more. So here's how to get started. Prior to the hackathon, go to stm32hackathon.com. Here you will find detailed information, tutorials, and examples to help you get started. You can also ask questions by clicking on the Ask a Question button that Sam mentioned earlier in the presentation. At the hackathon, swing by the ST table and pick up your Nucleo board and a USB cable. Select the connectivity module. Determine your connectivity medium and select a connectivity module. Find the sensors and I/O modules needed for your device. And finally, put your creature together using ARM's mbed development environment. There you go. Are you ready? On your mark, get set, code. Of course, as part of Team Embed, STMicroelectronics will be at the hackathon to support you. If you need assistance, Joe, Stuart, David, Slim, or Mike will be available to answer your questions. Get a head start on building your creature today. Visit stm32hackathon.com. Thank you very much, and see you in Vegas. Okay, I'll pass the baton to Michael.
Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So my name is Mike Lamon. I'm from u-blox. For this hackathon, we are bringing a cellular connectivity and positioning shield. Our cellular and positioning shield contains a AT&T certified UMTS HSPA modem. It is a SARA module. In addition, on the shield, we have a GNSS GPS receiver. This is a high sensitivity multi-GNSS receiver that allows you to determine the position of your device. This is done by a MAX module. The shield is fully Arduino compatible, and we will have external antennas that plug onto the shield and also AT&T SIM cards. As I already said, the shield is an Arduino compatible device. It takes power from the carrier board, which could be a Freescale or an STM32 nuclear board. Plug in your SIM card to the SIM holder on top, you connect the antenna, and you will communicate to this shield using the serial port and the I2C interface. The u-blox cellular and positioning shield is an mbed component. So there are libraries with mbed APIs for the cellular modem and for the positioning receiver. Just go to mbed.org and download, import your library to your project. The shield is also compatible with the AT&T M2X client, so you can forward the data that you get from your sensors to the AT&T data cloud, and it is compatible with the mbed SDK and operating system. We do have various examples available on mbed.org. You have two choices of mbed baseboards. On the left side, you see the shield plugged on top of a Freescale board. On the right side, you see the shield plugged on top of an SD board. Obviously, you can even stack now your sensor shields on top or connect additional devices. So, we recommend that you take a baseboard from either ST or Freescale. You select the u-blox cellular shield for your connectivity. You will use the AT&T cellular network to connect to the internet and move your data to the AT&T M2X cloud. And obviously, display all your data in your app or service that you will also develop. At the hackathon, we will be available with support. My colleague Ed and I will be there to assist you in case you run into problems. Thank you. So with this, I forward to Daniel.
Hello, can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so this is Daniel Ballou from Nordic Semiconductor, and I am here to talk to you about creating a custom embed sensor for your smart device using Bluetooth Smart and the Nordic MKit. So I'm going to talk to you about the highlights of Bluetooth Smart. I'm going to tell you about the MKit eval board that Nordic is bringing to the hackathon. I'll give you an overview of the current embed Bluetooth Smart API, and I will step through some important concepts in a sensor demo that I wrote for you. So first of all, Bluetooth Smart has very little in common with classic Bluetooth. It's also called Bluetooth Low Energy, and BLE was designed from the start to be very low power. This means that the radio is intended to spend most of its time idle, and when the radio is used, it's not expected to stay on for very long. Still a 2.4 gigahertz radio, but it's not compatible with classic Bluetooth. So along with a reduction in power consumption, we also get cheaper hardware because a simpler protocol requires fewer resources. As an example, the entire Nordic BLE stack requires less than 8 kilobytes of RAM. Just as a comparison, classic Bluetooth requires more than 8 times that much just to store the data that you could send over the link. Finally, nearly all Bluetooth Smart devices share data via a simple key-value data store called GAT. So here is some practical information. First of all, 100-foot line-of-sight range is possible, but most Bluetooth Smart devices are used much closer than that. The radio wants to be idle, so as of version 4.1 of the BLE spec, the max throughput is about 15 kilobytes per second. But the throughput can be throttled by various parameters and implementation details. So you should only expect to see about 5 to 10 kilobytes per second between two arbitrary devices that you don't know anything about beforehand. However, a device that doesn't spend much time trying to push a lot of data can easily go for months off of a coin cell battery. So there are currently 28 approved use cases. These are things like the human interface, device profile. Host platforms typically have some built-in support for accessing the data via these use cases. Lastly, on the host side, iOS introduced Bluetooth Smart with the iPhone 4S. Android got support in version 4.3, that's API level 18. and support on Windows Phone was very recent with version 8.1. So Nordic will be bringing our NRF51822M kit eval boards. Our NRF51 system on chip combines a Cortex M0, our flexible 2.4 gigahertz radio, and plenty of flash and RAM. The eval board itself has dozens of GPIO pins, a couple of LEDs and buttons to play with, and of course supports embeds, IDE, and drag and drop programming. So support for Bluetooth Smart and Embed was actually created with cooperation from Nordic, so many of the API calls are similar to Nordic's native BLE stack. However, the Embed API currently only supports using our device as a peripheral. So for example, you won't be able to link two Embed devices together over BLE at the hackathon. Of course, the easiest way to get started in Embed is to import code that already exists. And currently, there's library support for battery level, device information, device firmware updating, health thermometer, heart rate, and a service that turns BLE into a simple UART. So I created a simple example based on the UART service. Basically, I wanted to give you something that works out of the box with an existing application on the host side, so you can focus on getting started with the embedded side. In this example, all of the data is exchanged as a string. So for example, you're free to use SprintDef instead of worrying about various BLE data types. Also, the serial port is enabled for printing debug messages because there currently is no support for breakpoints in embed. You can create a useful program just by modifying single main.cpp file. So I'm going to kind of drill into the important parts of the example program that I have posted on my embed page. So if we start with main, in the Cortex M0, the main function is executed in the lowest priority context. So here all I do is schedule an interrupt for pulling my sensor and hit the stack, set up advertising so the host can find us, and then sleep whenever nothing else is going on in order to save power. The polling callback that I scheduled earlier is done at a higher priority, but it's still a low priority as far as interrupts are concerned. And here I have some breathing room to talk to slow sensors or do long computations because the stack can still interrupt me as needed when BLE events happen. For this example, I'm only reading an analog pin, assuming you've got an analog sensor, and I've got an example of that in the README on the embed site. If I wanted to, I could push new data to the host every time I read the sensor here. Finally, the host, when it sends data, I end up in this callback. This callback has a slightly higher priority than the polling context that we just looked at. Here, it's best to keep the execution short because I want to receive the next callback from the stack as soon as it happens. So I don't want to do any long polling or talk to any slow sensors here. In this case, I expect the host to be sending me a command. So I parse the command, and then I use this update characteristic value function to send a response back to the host. And here, this params care handle specifies the characteristics. So that's the key in the data store. And params len and params data are both used to specify the value that was sent to us from the host. So hopefully you can get a chance to check out that example. It's on my embed page. I will also try to add some extra hackathon code there in the coming weeks before the hackathon. NordicSemi.com, if you go there and create a MyPage login, you can use this product key that I have specified here. That'll unlock all of the tools and data sheets that we have for that board, including schematics and things like that, so you can do some homework. Devzone.nordicsemi.com it's an open forum that's also staffed by Nordic employees. It's got lots of questions and lots of answers about common Bluetooth scenarios and hardware-specific stuff. And also developer.nordicsemi.com contains the SDK source code that we have available for our NRF51 series. So that, for example, has a lot of reference code for the various BLE use cases, so you can easily find UUIDs and things like that. So with that, I will pass it back. So this is David Smith from Multitech.
Here, Multitech. There we go. I'm a little slow at this, so bear with me. In any case, we are happy to return with Team Embed to the AT&T Developer Summit and Hackathon in Las Vegas in 2015. Our part of this is to be providing a wireless module. It works in ISM band, so that's 902 megahertz for those of you who are interested. This module is an mdot. It provides a XB compatible footprint. And so along with our module, we will be providing an Arduino shield adapter from SparkFun that will allow you to plug this module onto any of the provided embed development boards at the hackathon. It's based on a technology by a company called Semtech, called LoRa. And it's a long range, low power, radio technology based on digital spread spectrum, or even more farther back, a chirp technology. You may have heard of that. This board is meant to be used in two different modes. You can make it a master or a slave. And the reason why we can do that is we have a STM32F411 processor on this module that is fully embed programmable if you want to use it to be the brains of a system to do such things as sensor data acquisition and so forth. That would be a master mode application. It also comes in with a built-in set of software by default that you can use it as a slave and just give it AT commands to do different things. Generally, you're going to be using this to connect through our conduit gateways out to the internet, and we've set them all up so that it is very easy to take your data from your embed platform out to the AT&T M2X cloud. So here we have two different programming methods to use. I'll start with the slave mode. That's actually pretty simple. Basically, it uses a UART. You send it AT commands. We have a quick start guide that lists all these AT commands for you. They're very, very simple. Such things as connect, send, and receive. It will allow you to get data all the way out to the M2X cloud pretty transparently. You can also go to the embed site, and we have this program on that site, and you can modify it as well if you have special things you'd like to do. In addition to that, though, if you're working in master mode where you want to do a little more intensive computing on this module, we provide a set of embed libraries. We allow you to, and an API, to connect to and set up your M2X account and to compile your code and drag and drop it onto the module. We'll also be providing our developer board, and again with a quick start guide that shows you how to use this. It looks pretty complicated, it's really not. This board would be used if you're working in master mode and you were going to plug your MDOT onto it, and it would be this board that you would connect to your laptop to do your drag and drop of your embed binary. Also, as part of being a Team Embed member, we're fully compatible with the STM Nucleo board and the Freescale board, so that if you decide to just use it as a slave or as a master, you could probably do it either way, I guess, but mostly as a slave, you can use the supplied Arduino shield adapter and plug it onto our partners' boards. In addition to that, you can stack on the Seed Studio sensor board to do your data acquisition through. And so you can use this in a lot of different scenarios, everything from your car to your home, any sensor you want to connect up to, through the Multitech conduit network and up to the M2X platform. very transparently. So we're looking forward to seeing you all in Las Vegas and wish you the best of luck.
Thank you, David. So let me see if we have any questions in the Q&A manager. I had one for Ian. I think that's taken care of. You guys would like to put your questions in the Q&A manager? That would be great. If not, this session is being recorded and will be posted to our developer program YouTube page at youtube.com/ATTDev. So that's usually a frequent question we get. You can also reach out to the team embed team through their various channels. I believe we have a slide, Sam, that has all of your information on it. Maybe I have that. I do. Let me show that to you guys. Here is all the contact information for So if you guys want to contact anybody from the Team Embed team, here is the link that you can use. And I believe each one of them shared their links as well. So thank you, Team Embed, for presenting how to develop connected car, home, and wearable applications. Hopefully this presentation will help those of you that are going to the AT&T Developer Summit Hackathon and Conference on site. They will also be there to help you as well. This presentation and all the other Bootstrap Week presentations will be made available later this week or next on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/attdev, as well as on our developer program blog, which is developer.att.com. Thank you, everyone, for participating in this Bootstrap Week event. If you're interested, you can see the rest of our Bootstrap presentations. They continue throughout the rest of the week. At attdeveloper.webex.com. Thank you, guys.